The meeting is called to order. A very good evening to one and all present here. It's gratifying to look around and see so many familiar faces. That's a pleasing welcome to what I know is going to be a great lecture on the Quin-Decennial lecture series. May I now kindly request our president of MMBA, Madam N. Krishnaveni, to formally welcome the gathering.
Honorable Mr. Justice R. Subramanian, Senior Advocate Mr. Meenaksh Sundaram, Senior Advocate Mr. T.V. Shivakumar, Mr. K.N. Thambi, Ramesh Alayas Ramaya, Srinivas Raghavan, and youngsters, office bearers of various associations and office bearers of MMBA, good evening to all. Today, this is the second lecture under the Quin-Decennial lecture series. Today's topic is Inheritance and Devolution, an overview of Section 6 and 8 of Hindu Succession Act. Whenever you read Section 6 and 8, it will be very, very, very simple. Whenever you want to apply that to a case, it is the very, very most difficult section. So when to make it simple and when to make it difficult? When we are an appellant, it should be simple. When we are on the other side, it should be difficult. So we have to balance that. So when is it is simple and when it is difficult? Today we have Honorable Mr. Justice R. Subramanian to deliver a lecture on an overview of Section 6 and 8 of Hindu Succession Act. Nowadays, whenever any lecture series is conducted in any association, first of all, priority is given to only criminal side and next to constitution. Very rarely, a topic under civil law is taken. Today we are very glad that apart from Honorable Judge or Judge's legal luminary, particularly in civil cases, civil side, he has ample practice at civil side. So we expect he will throw light on this subject to us and will enlighten us on this subject. With these few words, I welcome Honorable Justice R. Subramanian for this, and I welcome all who are present here for this function. Thank you all.
Thank you, Madam. As a gesture of love and gratitude, on behalf of MMBA, I would like to request President Madam N. Krishnaveni to honor the guest speaker for the evening, Honorable Mr. Justice R. Subramanian, with a shawl and a small memento. Thank you, Lordship. Thank you, ma'am. Though our honorable distinguished speaker, His Lordship, hardly needs any introduction since the occasion demands, I now request Mr. S. Srinivasa Raghavan to give a brief introduction about His Lordship.
Happy evening. The word brief gives me an alert so that I may be short and precise. Nammudaiya sirappu virundarukku vandu arimugam kudrathu thevailla nenikirena, because he is known to everybody and his judgment speaks for him. So instead of going for a usual way of introducing him, like when he got enrolled, when he was born, I want to just say two things. Giving lectures is not something new to him. He has been one of the cherished, much appreciated resource persons of Tamil Nadu State Judicial Academy. And unfortunately, Madurai Academy did not have the occasion to hear his lecture because it was formed much later. But whenever you go and visit Chennai Academy, his name will be always remembered by the persons who were imparted law by him. Second thing is that unlike some of us, he does not belong to a generation of lawyers. He is from an agricultural family from Tanjore, and he is the first generation lawyer from his family. So a first generation lawyer from Tanjore has gone to Chennai for education, studied law, and joined a very good a doyen of bar called Mr. Krishnan, we call him affectionately Palatop Krishnan, and has acquired all the knowledge which the senior has imparted him, and thus he rose to the particular stage. So for these two things, I think this introduction is much enough. And as I already said, his judgment speaks for himself. It will speak forever. And I welcome the Chief Guest.
Thank you, sir, for that brief yet candid intro. Learning is not attained by chance. It must be sought for with order and attained with diligence. Without wasting any more time, I would like to call upon Honorable Mr. Justice R. Subramanian to deliver the second quindecennial lecture on the topic Inheritance and Devolution, an overview of Section 6 and 8 of the Hindu Succession Act.
My good friend and president of the Madurai bench of Madras High Court Bar Association, Senior Advocate Krishnaveni, office bearers of the association, senior advocates, and my friends at the bar, a very good evening to all of you. I must thank Madam Krishnaveni for giving me this opportunity to address you on this topic, which by now many of you must know is very dear to me. And people think that there is a general impression that Hindu Succession Act has brought about a great change in the succession of a male Hindu's property, and it has rewritten the law of succession. To be honest and to be right, that is not the case. If you look at Section 4 of the Act, it said all customary Hindu law that was in vogue, which is inconsistent with the provisions of the new act, alone will stand abrogated. And one very important feature of Shastric Hindu law, namely the copassanary concept, was retained by Section 6. As you all know, the Hindus, the law relating to succession of Hindus was in two major schools of law, that is Mithakshara and Dayabhaga. While Dayabhaga law was in force in certain territories of India, particularly Bengal and Assam, the other territories followed Mithakshara. But even in the other territories which followed Mithakshara, there was a change. The Bombay school differed from the Madras school and the Banaras school of Hindu law, while Kerala followed a totally different concept of Marmakathayam succession. This joint Hindu family is a concept known only to Hindu law. No other law or no other school of law recognizes this joint Hindu family system. And joint Hindu family is a broader concept, and copassanary is within the joint Hindu family a smaller concept where only male members can be part of the copassanary. Till, say, in some states, it started in 1986 with Andhra Pradesh enacting a law enabling daughters to be copassanas with their father. That was followed by Tamil Nadu in 1989. Then Maharashtra Act came. Several states started enacting these laws. Then the Central Act 39 of 2005 came, which made daughters co-passanas with their fathers. I underline the word father because there is some gray area in that, whether it is the father or the brother. Anyway, that I'll touch upon it at a later point of time. The Hindu succession itself was a patrilineal system, and it was more lean towards men, because that is not, now we say it is unjust or it is not, discrimination against women. No, that is not the case, because under the Shastric Hindu law, a daughter in a family on a marriage becomes the part of the other family. She ceases to have any relationship with this family property-wise. So she becomes a part of the other family. She gets the rights in her husband's property or in her father-in-law's property, as the case may be. So in tune, the law of succession prior to 1956 was in tune with the Shastric Hindu tradition, which she becomes a part of the other gotra. So she can't succeed to the estate of her father. That was the concept. It is not like, of course, it is a patrilineal system, but that system had its own meaning and its own reasons for having such a patrilineal system. And another peculiar feature of this Mitakshara Kopasanari law or concept of Mitakshara Kopasanari is joint ownership. The son, grandson and the great-grandson will get a right by birth. All of them will own a joint share in the property, but they can't demand partition. The grandson and the great-grandson cannot demand partition. The son can. And this joint concept of joint ownership is also very peculiar to Hindu law. It is not available in any other school of law. Then how did the law relating to succession evolve in India particularly? It is not as if the Hindu Succession Act is the first act which came into being. The British enacted certain laws covering specific period, specific group of people. The first one was the Removal of Caste Disabilities Act 1850. That brought about a major change in the succession. The Removal of Caste Disabilities Act 1850 enabled converts to succeed, but it disabled descendants of a convert from succeeding to the property. Now that is incorporated under Section 26 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956. Then another landmark was the Hindu Wills Act 1870. The concept of will was not known to India or the Hindu law. Then in 1870, this Hindu Wills Act came, enabling a Hindu to bequeath property under a will. That later, it became Hindu Transfer of Bequests Act 1914, that was enacted by the Madras Presidency. These two enactments put together, came the Hindu Disposition of Property Act 1916. And these provisions of Hindu Disposition of Property Act 1916 were incorporated under the Indian Succession Act 1925. So that became a part. Then 1956, Section 30 came to enable a Hindu to execute or a will with reference to his share in the property. He cannot execute a will in respect of the entire property. He can confine it to his share in the property. This is regarding the testamentary succession. A major change, if we can call it, where the women were given a right to property of a male Hindu, came in 1937. By way of the Hindu Women's Right to Property Act. That we say that law will not apply to agricultural lands. Why and how? This law came in 1937. That was preceded by what is called the Government of India Act in 1935. This Government of India Act can be called a predecessor to the Indian Constitution. That is when, by the Government of India Act, the provincial governments were established in India. Then, like we have constitution now, list 1, list 2, list 3, state list, central list and the concurrent list. Like that, there was a list 1 and list 2. The central, the union had a right to enact certain laws in respect of certain subjects, and the states, the provinces were given a right to enact certain laws under certain subjects. Under that, the subject of agricultural lands was given to the state subject. It was given to the provincial subject. Therefore, when this act, this Hindu Women's Right to Property Act 1937 was challenged in 1942, to be precise, in the judgment reported in 1941 FCR page 72, the federal court struck down the act in respect of agricultural lands and said, you have no right to enact a law in respect of agricultural lands. Thereafter, the legislatures woke up and they came out with their own laws. The provincial legislatures came out with their own laws and the Madras Presidency came out with its own act in the year 1947, and in which limited right was given to a woman in her husband's property equal to that of a son. So, wherever a Hindu male dies, his wife had a limited right to the property of that Hindu male, and she will get as a limited owner. On her death, it was to revert back to his heirs. Reversion. They are called the reversion or the vested remainder men. So this was there from 1947 to 1956. Then in 1956, the Hindu Succession Act provided for enlargement of this estate under section 14.1 and 14.2. Whether that enlargement, how does it operate, and 14.1, 14.2, whether 14.2 is a proviso to 14.1 or it operates as an explanation to 14.1, these are all subject matter of serious controversy between 1956 and 1977. In 1977, the Supreme Court came out with Tulasamma's case where they said, they laid down the guidelines and said, this is what the scope of section 14.1 and 14.2. 14.2 is actually a proviso to 14.1. And if a limited estate has been given under an instrument or a decree of court prior to 1956, it should be treated as done in recognition of the then existing law. Therefore, that will also blossom into an absolute estate. That was the conclusion of the Supreme Court, which fortunately still holds good. Anyway, now then, coming to the Hindu Succession Act, Section 4, I already said Section 4, effect of Section 4. Then the most important sections, two sections are the fulcrum of this act, or Section 6 and Section 8. Section 6, I will not read the sections for you because I am addressing a group of lawyers, very eminent people. So I will just tell you what exactly the essence of it. Section 6 provided for succession to copassionary property or ancestral property. Then Section 8 provided for succession to self-acquired property of a male Hindu. Section 6, as it stood unamended prior to 39 of 2005, was like it said, the property of a male Hindu who dies intestate after the commencement of the Hindu Succession Act 1956, the word used is, his interest in the Miktakshara Kopasanari will devolve under Section 8 and not by survivorship. It never said the old Hindu law relating to Kopasanari will continue to apply. But it said his interest in the Miktakshara Kopasanari will devolve under 8 and not by survivorship. Because the earlier law was, the property of a male Hindu who dies intestate will devolve on his surviving male copassanas. That is called devolution by survivorship. That's why I use the words devolution and inheritance in the topic. Devolution is one thing, inheritance is another. While under Section 6, the property of a male Hindu will devolve by survivorship, except his interest in the Miktakshara Kopasanari. Then Section 6.3 said, how do you find out his interest in the Miktakshara Kopasanari? Then it said, you imagine a notional partition. A notional partition is to be taken just before the death of the male Hindu. And whatever share that would have been allotable to him under the notional partition would be his separate property, which will devolve under 8. It can be explained by an example very easily. You take a male Hindu dying sometime in 1957, leaving two sons and a wife and a daughter. What do you do to ascertain? So, you will have to first ascertain what will be his interest in the Miktakshara Kopasanari at the time of his death. What do you do to ascertain that? You assume a partition just prior to his death. He has left behind two sons who are copassanas. So, if you assume that the male Hindu who died is A, and X and Y are the sons, A will get one third, his two sons will get one third. So now, we have ascertained the interest of the male Hindu in the Miktakshara Kopasanari, that will be one third. And this one third will devolve under 8 among the class 1 heirs. The class 1 heirs are wife, the two daughters and the two sons. So 5. So 1 by 15th. This 1 by 15th is added to this 1/3. So the sons will each of the son will get about 6 by 15, and the daughters and the mother will get 1 by 15 each. This is a plain calculation. But a son who has got this, the problem arises in the next step. A son who has acquired this 6 by 15, he has not got it from one source. He has got it from two different sources. One is as a kopasanar, and the other is as a heir of his father under 8. There are two different kinds of properties in the hands of the son who gets that property. So when his succession opens, there comes the problem actually. When his succession opens, what happens is, there are two kinds of properties. One that will devolve under 8, and the other will go by survivorship under 6. So you can't apply 8 fully or 6 fully. It has to be again split. This 1 by 15th which he got as a heir of the father will go under 8, and this 1/3 which he got as a kopasanar will go under 6. This cropped up. Several judgments were there, and one of the major, very important and a path-breaking judgment was a full bench of the Madras High Court. And one peculiar feature you will find if you analyze Hindu law, and I can say tax law is one of the sources of Hindu law. All important judgments covering succession under Hindu law would have arisen under the Income Tax Act. That HUF is a different concept. You will be dragged on to somewhere else if you put HUF. Even joined into family, what happens is, this Madras case, 1979 Madras page 1, there was one Palaniappa Chettiar. He and his son Karuppan had entered into a partition even prior to 1956. So Palaniappa Chettiar was given certain properties and Karuppan was given certain properties. Then on the death of Palaniappa Chettiar, Karuppan being the only son, he inherited all the properties allotted to Palaniappa Chettiar under the partition. But with the property which he got in the partition with his father, he has formed a Hindu undivided family. That is a concept known only to income tax law, because he is allowed to have two assessments. Now, as a person who has inherited property from my ancestral nucleus, I am permitted to have two assessments. One is my individual assessment as a lawyer or a judge, and the other is a HUF assessment as a manager of the Hindu undivided family consisting of my wife and my son, or my sons or children. So you can have two assessments. So the concept was introduced in Income Tax Act to benefit those who have two sources of income, one from their ancestral property and other from their avocation. This concept, so this Karuppan, who is the son, who inherited this property from two sources, wanted to have this property which he inherited from Palaniappa as his own self-acquisition. And he wanted to show the property which he got under the partition. So this is where you see the difference between devolution and inheritance. This, whatever he got from Palaniappa was by inheritance. Whatever he got at the partition between him and Palaniappa was by devolution, because he had a right by birth earlier. So this property was there. So this Karuppan, he showed this property which he got under the partition as a HUF property, and this property inherited from Palaniappa, he wanted it to be his self-acquired. So he wanted to have two assessments. The Income Tax Department said, no, you can't do that. Now you are the owner of this property also, you are the owner of that property also. Where is the question of two different successions? Then the question arose, that matter was referred to the full bench by the Income Tax Department. The full bench, after going elaborate discussion on law, finally concluded the assessee's claim was right. He had the character of property was two. It was not one single property. It didn't come from one single source. It came from two different sources. But while Madras, Allahabad and Bombay High Courts took the same view, Gujarat High Court took a different view. It agreed with the department's contention. Then this controversy was resolved subsequently by the Supreme Court in Chandrasen's case later in the year 1986. So now going to the Madras High Court judgment, in reported in AIR 1979 Madras page 1, that is Palaniappa versus Karpan. There the full bench had considered one very important aspect which I started as an opening remark. This is what they say. Before dealing with the Allahabad High Court decision and the Gujarat High Court decision, these two conflicting decisions were placed before the full bench. The full bench said, we would like to refer to the salient provisions of the Act referring to the preamble of the statute. It is clear that what was intended by enacting the statute was to provide for interstate succession among Hindus. The preamble reads, an act to amend and codify the law relating to interstate succession among Hindus. See the preamble. It is not an act to introduce a new succession. It is an act to amend and codify the law relating to interstate succession among Hindus. Now turning to section 4 of the Act, we find that only a limited overriding is intended by the passing of the Act. 41A says, save otherwise expressly provided in this Act, any text, rule or interpretation of Hindu law or any custom or usage as part of the law in force immediately before the commencement of this Act shall cease to have effect. What follows is more important, shall cease to have effect with respect to any matter for which a provision is made in this Act. So the customary succession was abrogated only to a limited extent, not fully. This is what the bench has said. It is seen from 41A, the same limitation contained in 41B as well. From this, it is possible to conclude that the statute has no intention whatever of abrogating the principles of Hindu law in toto or in a comprehensive manner, and that intends only to affect those principles to the extent to which provision had been made in the Act which abrogates or strikes a discordant note to the principles of established Hindu Mithakshara law. Then they go on to consider section 6. And finally, the division bench, the full bench said, in paragraph 10 of the judgment, they make a distinction. This is a case where a person who had obtained property under partition died. His name was Palaniappa. When he died, his son Karuppan was alive. We are concerned with the property which Palaniappa had obtained in the partition. In that partition, Karuppan was also a party. We are concerned with the question of devolution of the property of Palaniappa, which he obtained in the partition and which had devolved on some persons after his death. Not only was Karuppan alive at the time of death of Palaniappa, but at the time of his death, Karuppan's son was also alive. In such circumstances, under Hindu law, the property will devolve on the son and the grandson. And the grandson will also have an interest in the property, and the two together will form a Hindu undivided family. We are, of course, assuming that there were no females. Then they go to the other question. The question is whether, when succession opens under Section 8, Karuppan and his son will take the property in the same manner. Clearly, this is not so. When we search for the relatives mentioned in Class 1 of the schedule, which is attracted by virtue of 8, we find no son's son are mentioned at all, though the grandson of a deceased son is mentioned. What will be the effect when such grandson comes into the picture need not be dealt with in this case. But where sons as well as his sons are the persons concerned, by applying 8, we have to come to the conclusion that the father alone, namely Karuppan in this case, will inherit the property to the exclusion of grandson. This being the effect of the statutory provision, no interest will accrue to the grandson in the property which belonged to Palaniappa. Even assuming Palaniappa's property is ancestral property in the hands of Karuppan, still, because of the effect of the statute, Karuppan's son will not have an interest in the property. This is directly derogatory of the law established according to the principles of Hindu law, and this provision is in the statute must prevail in view of the unequivocal expression of the intention in the statute, which says to the extent to which provisions had been made in the statutes, those provisions shall override the established provisions of Hindu law. So the bench for the first time made a distinction between two kinds of properties. And subsequently, this judgment itself was challenged in the Supreme Court, but before that appeal could be disposed of, the Supreme Court considered this very question in another case, in Chandarsan versus CIT, where the Supreme Court said that was a three-judge bench that is reported in 1986 3 SCC, page 571 or 567, where they considered the entire, all the high courts, the decisions of all the high courts were considered, and finally in para 25 the Supreme Court said in the aforesaid light, the views expressed by the Allahabad High Court, Madras High Court and Madhya Pradesh High Court and the Andhra Pradesh High Court appear to us to be correct. With respect, we are unable to agree with the views of the Gujarat High Court noted above. Therefore, this principle laid down by the full bench in 1979 was affirmed by the Supreme Court in 1986. The appeal against the judgment in Karpan Jettiar's case itself came up in 1993 and it was dismissed following Chandarsan. And this was also followed in Yudhishthira versus CIT in 1987 Supreme Court. A lot of judgments are there. But in the recent past, there are some cases of the Supreme Court where a discordant note is struck, where they say that a son born after 1956 would not acquire a right by birth. That discordant note is against the judgment of the full bench of Madras High Court, but Supreme Court is there, but Chandrasen is a three-judge bench where the law enunciated by the full bench of Madras High Court was affirmed, thereby providing for the copassionary property to continue as it is and providing for a right by birth to children born after 1958-56 also. And recently came a judgment of Justice Nariman in Uttam versus Saubhag Singh and others. But lot of, I think as far as that judgment is concerned, we must, if you look at it dispassionately and on a deep reading, the last paragraph is, but the law laid down is in conformity with Chandrasen's case. I would only request draw your reference to in paragraph 20, the division bench, after referring to that Shama Rao Agwale's case and Rohit Chauhan's case, says the law therefore in so far as it applies to joint family property governed by Mitakshara school prior to the amendment 2005 could therefore be summarized as follows. In that paragraph 4, this is what the court says: in order to determine the share of a Hindu male copassioner who is governed by section 6 proviso, a partition is effected by operation of law immediately before his death. In this partition, all the copassioners and the male Hindu's widow get a share in the joint family property. Next, on application of section 8, either by reason of death of a male Hindu leaving self-acquired property or by application of section 6 proviso, that is where you must, the judgment is very clear. It says on application of section 8, either by reason of a death of a male Hindu leaving self-acquired property, no doubt 8 will apply, then or by application of section 6 proviso, what is that you get under the proviso? That notional partition, that his interest in the family, that comes in under the proviso. So, or by application of section 6 proviso, such property would devolve only by intestacy and not by survivorship. This is what the full bench said in 1979, and that was affirmed in Chandrasen in 1983, followed by Yudhishthira in 1987. All these cases take the same view. But now this judgment, because of the last paragraph, because if you look at the facts of Uttam, that was concerned with succession to self-acquisition of a male Hindu. So therefore they said because he has got it under 8, his son will not get a pre-existing right or a right by birth. Therefore, this Uttam's case cannot be taken as a law to say that after 1956 the concept of copassanary stands abrogated. If you say that, the results will be disastrous, because you have several state enactments which held the field between at least 1986 to 2005. Various states have enacted laws making daughters copassanas along with their father. And if you are going to say a daughter born after 1956 will not get the benefit of those enactments, what happens? The very purpose and intent of these enactments will go, including Act 39 of 2005, which brought in the change by amending Section 6 and making daughters also copassanas along with their father. So this concept, see, the intent of the Supreme Court was not to say that these laws will become oshis. Therefore it is, because in the first paragraph, Justice Nariman uses the word as Section 6 stood prior to this amendment in 2005. So he is interpreting the section as it stood prior to the amendment. So if the section that stood prior to the amendment is taken to mean that sons born after 1956 will not by birth get a right, the same would logically apply to the daughters also. So therefore, this entire set of laws, right from starting with Andhra Pradesh first state was Andhra Pradesh to get it in 1986, followed by Tamil Nadu in 1989, Karnataka, then Maharashtra, all the Orissa also brought in an enactment. So all these acts will become oshis if this interpretation, of course there are some judgments of the Supreme Court which say that a son born after 1956 will not get a right prior to 2005. But those judgments, if you look at it, I have referred to them in my judgment in Pundipankar's case, where I have said because of the three-judge bench decision in Chandrasen, those judgments should not be taken as a precedent. Because the three-judge, and those judgments, if you look at it, all of them are by the same judge, and first judgment will not have any reasons. It will suddenly say, this guy born after 1956, therefore he is not entitled to. The second judgment will say in view of the first judgment. The third judgment will say in view of the first two judgments. That's all. Therefore, a very mischievous lawyer did that. When I took up Pundipankar's case, I had discussed with him this very question. As a lawyer, we had discussed. When I sat on the bench, he came and said, now take this. Uttam has confirmed that judgment. Now answer me. And I said, fine, I will take your challenge. That is not, see, because we know what it is. Therefore, this came as a point. I was happy that it came before me and I was able to deal with it, which provided me a lot of opportunity to do a complete research on Hindu law. I took quite a long time to deliver the judgment because I wanted it to be pakka and precise. I didn't dictate it in the open court as I do in some cases, because it involves some interpretation and some application of mind. Therefore, I did a lot of research on that. I even took up some of the old texts of Hindu law, looked at what is the pattern by which it goes. Therefore, just by one or two judgments of the Supreme Court this way, that way, we cannot say the law is settled like this. But when we make a full research, the very unavoidable result will be that the copassanary concept is still retained. It is not totally abrogated by the Hindu Succession Act. And what very important thing, fortunately, the theory of notional partition has not been done away with under the amended section 6 also. The amended section 6 also does not say that a notional partition will not that theory of notional partition will stand abrogated. If you look at the amended section 6, where a Hindu dies, it says, on and from the commencement of the Hindu Succession Act, in a joint Hindu family governed by Mitashtra law, the daughter of a Kopasanar shall, by birth, become a Kopasana in her own right. Where a Hindu dies after the commencement of the Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005, his interest in the property of the joint Hindu family governed by Mitashtra law shall devolve by testamentary intestate succession as the case may be under this act and not by survivorship. Here again, survivorship is protected. So, take this subsection 3 of section 6 as it stands today was the main section 6 before the amendment. So, section 3 stands as it is. It protects survivorship. Therefore, the legislative intent was to protect survivorship and provide for devolution of property or inheritance of property under 8 also. Then again, it says, for the purposes of this section, the interest of a Hindu Mitashtra Kopasana shall be deemed to be the share in the property that would have been allotted to him if a partition of the property had not taken place immediately before his death, irrespective whether he was entitled to claim partition or not. Therefore, the theory of notional partition is also retained. Therefore, to say a son born after 1958 will not become a Kopasanar, the entire theory of Kopasanari stands abrogated, all those things may not be correct. Then next important thing is, what is the nature of course, it is pending in a reference before a larger bench of the Supreme Court, whether this 2005 Act is retrospective or retroactive or prospective. That we can, if you look at the Act itself, that one of the earliest judgment, I think, was in by Justice M. Srinivasan, immediately after the Act came, was in Shanmugavadayar's case, where he said, I don't have the immediate citation. Shanmugavadayar's case, where Justice M. Srinivasan said, it should be shown that the father was alive on the date when the Act came into force. Because 29A of the Tamil Nadu Act, as it stood, made a daughter a Kopasanar along with her father and not along with her brothers. And one more reasoning given by the learned judge, which is more appealing, is on the death of the Hindu, male Hindu, what happens? Property cannot remain in isolation or in suspended animation. It has to vest in somebody. So on the death of a male Hindu, leaving ancestral property, what happens? His sons take a major share as Kopasanas, then his wife gets a share in his property. Under the notional partition, we arrive at his interest in the Kopasanari property is arrived at by way of a notional partition. That devolves on the class 1 heirs. A wife is a class 1 heir. A daughter prior to 1990 is a class 1 heir. But the 90 Act contained one other disqualification, is a daughter who gets married prior to the commencement of the Act will not get a right. So if there is a daughter who was married in 1985, she will get only as a class 1 heir, she will not become a Kopasana. So, a particular share is vested in those two categories of people, the widow and a married daughter. If the share of this daughter, whose father had died before 1989, is enlarged by making her a Kopasana, suppose let us take a case where a father dies leaving behind one son and an unmarried daughter. There is a widow also. Notional partition, if you apply half to the father, half to the son. The half of the son will devolve on the daughter, the mother and the son. So 1/6 each. This 1/6 is vested in the mother. Is there any provision divesting that 1/6 from her? Suppose you make the daughter a Kopasanar, what happens? 1/3. The interest of the male Hindu will become 1/3 instead of half. that one third will have to devolve on the three. That is the son, daughter and the widow. So the widow's share from 1/6 will come to 1/9. Where is the concept of reduction? There is nothing to show that the act really intended a divestment of the share. This was the reasoning on which Justice Srinivasan said, this will not. But unfortunately what happened was, and that judgment in Shanmugodaya's case, he had based it on two grounds. One is this, the other is a final decree was not passed. A preliminary decree for partition was passed. The learned judge said, preliminary decree for partition will end in disruption of the joint family. So a preliminary decree will have the effect of disruption. Therefore, this daughter cannot get a right. That reasoning, the second part of it, was Andhra Pradesh said even a preliminary decree, that was the case of Sai Reddy versus Narayan Reddy, that was reported in 1986, immediately after the Andhra Act, 1987 or 88 in Andhra. Andhra Pradesh High Court said, unless the final decree is passed, a daughter will get a right. That went up on appeal. And in the appeal, the Supreme Court affirmed that judgment. Then in 1990, when that judgment was brought before a bench consisting of Justice Srinivasan and Thangamani, I think Deva Sigamani Pillai or something, and there they took note of that judgment and said, in view of this, my view in Shanmugodayar is not correct. But in the second case, Devanayagam Pillai, the father, was very much alive. He was a party to the proceeding. He was the appellant before the High Court. Therefore, the question whether the father should be alive or not was not gone into in the second judgment of the division bench. But everybody, we flock of sheep, everybody automatically said, no, Srinivasan himself has said Shanmugodayar is bad law. No, that was not, that question never arose in the second case. Then of course now division bench said, followed Justice Srinivasan's first judgment and said it is only prospective, our division bench has said. Then now the Supreme Court has taken different views, and therefore the matter is subject matter of a reference before the Supreme Court. There we stand. We do not know what will be the result. We have to expect. We have to wait in anticipation only for that. Yet another thing which I wanted to highlight today regarding this joint family when we are at it. Then this working of shares. In one case where I had to deal with on the original side, this Kanaka Lakshmi was somebody that is also reported. Where I had to work out this two different shares. I told you there are two kinds of properties. One is the one devolving under section 6 and the other inherited under 8. One man died leaving behind 14 children. And of the 14 children, three sons pre-deceased him. And three sons pre-deceased their mother. And it was working out the shares was really, it took me almost a day. Finally, I came to the conclusion that each of the plaintiff would be entitled to 127 by 10,854 shares. Then one judge sent a message to me, how could it be allotted? I said, that is not my problem. I have worked out the share as per the law. Execution part of it is not my concern when I am concerned with the preliminary decree. And a lot of people find it very difficult to calculate the shares. This was taught by my senior to me. And certain things my senior will put it in a very lighter vein. He will say, you allot shares, you work out the shares, fine. How do you find out whether it is right or wrong? You don't calculate the plaintiff's share alone. You calculate the defendant's share also. Add up everything, it must come to one. Then your sharing is right. If it does not come to one, you have done some mistake somewhere. So that is how you must find out. And this calculation bothers many people, including sometimes I had struggled with that, but with great difficulty, because I had this in mind, I used to manage with some kind of difficulty. We will try to push it in and say that this is what it is. So the very simple method to find out whether your share worked out is right or wrong, all that you got to do is add up all the shares, see that it comes to one, you are right. If it doesn't come to one, you are wrong. Finished. That is a very simple method by which you can be sure of the sharing pattern, how it is done. But if you are going to apply 79 Madras and Chandrasen very seriously, have two kinds of properties, calculate devolution, and Hindu law is the most complicated subject as far as the sharing pattern is concerned, because you have two kinds of properties. Suppose now you take my son. I have some property inherited, I have some property allotted to me at a partition between me, my father and my brother. And I have some property which I have inherited on the death of my father. So I have two kinds of properties in my hands. And when my succession opens, of course I have only one son, therefore there is no problem, but the character of property which he retains, the property which I got under the partition between me and my father will be ancestral in his hands. The property which I got from my father under 8 will be self-acquisition. It is self-acquisition in my hands and it will devolve only under 8. And when it comes to him, there will be another share which he inherits from me under 8. Notional partition, I will get half, he will get half. In that half, my wife will get half, he will get half. So 1/4. This property which he gets from me under 8 and that 1/4 put together, imagine the confusion that is created. That is one problem which has still not been solved, because see, it is a succession act is, if I may say so, is a half-hearted attempt to abolish the joint family system. Either it should have gone full throttle to say no joint family, no ancestral, nothing, everything will be held, or it should have stood by that, said only survivorship. This halfway through, one part is going by survivorship, other part going by inheritance under 8, will only lead to these kind of problems. And the one share, if I get 1/4 from my father at a partition between me and him, 1/2, and I inherit from my father the other half, this half will go under 8. So where my wife and son will take equally. The other half which I get under the partition will go under 6, where my son and me will get half, and that other half will be divided between my wife and my son, 1/4, 1/4. So it becomes very difficult to calculate the shares. But the law is there, we got to do it. So there is no escape from that. But if I am to sum it up, it's already 6:15, if I am to sum it up, my conclusion or my impression of this section 6 and 8, as well as the attempted disruption of joint family by the Act in 1956, as rightly pointed out by the full bench, it is only a limited abrogation of the rules of succession under the Mitashara Kopasanari, and where the character of property remains the same, and we have only a division, a slight change in the law in respect of a particular portion of the property of the father which goes under 8. And the remaining portion devolves only by survivorship, and that goes on and on and on unless there is a complete stoppage. and it goes to, or now even if it, earlier if it goes to a female heir, it would become her separate property. Now with the amended section 6, she also takes it as a kopasana, and it is held by her with all incidents of kopasanari. That is section new section 6.2. So we are widening the confusion. Much more confusion is likely to arise when a partition suit is laid to a share which a daughter got from her father in, as a kopasana. There again, you will have to apply section 6, parent section 6. There again, it will be a devolution by survivorship. And there, whether it will include her male and female heirs, that is another question. So all these things will come up. Now we see after the 2005, there is a sprout in suits for partition by daughters. And a 70-year-old daughter filing a suit for partition because her father happened to die in 2006. 70-year-old lady. I came across a second appeal where a 70-year-old lady filed a suit for partition claiming that she is a kopasana because her father died in December 2005. That son will be cursing him. And you know, so many alienations had happened, so many things have happened, but the property still remain undivided and major improvements were made. All those things are there. But this is a law with a kind of a social object in mind. Yes, that has to be there. But at the same time, this law should not create further confusion, the already existing confusion. But the eventual result has been a further confusion. But it has to be solved. And now that the Supreme Court is at it, I think we will expect something good. With this, I thank you all for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Lordship, for endowing us with your enlightening lecture and helping us untangle the knots of Hindu Succession Act. May I now request Mrs. Chitra Devi, EC member, to present the vote of thanks.
Very good evening to all. Now, we have come to the end of the program. Before we wind up, a few words of warmth with thank you notes. On behalf of MMBA, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our Lordship, who was spending his time from his busiest schedule to grace the occasion. Your Lordship, sharing of knowledge with us in the topic and overview of Section 6 and 8 of Hindu Succession Act is outstanding. Once again, thank you, Lordship. And I must mention our deepest sense of appreciation and hearty thanks to our beloved president and all other office bearers for organizing the function. Then special thanks to those who have been the backbone of the function, respected seniors, beloved advocate friends and staff of MMBA. We heard a wonderful learning experience and we hope to have more and more lecture series in future. Evermore, we thank all for your cordial cooperation today. Thank you very much.